LiveHipHopDaily.tv.
Yo. Yeah. Boy, that was right on time, y'all.
That was perfect.
Right on. Yeah. Y'all hear that in the background, right?
Let play a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah, let it roll a little bit. Especially if I know my baby. Do I? Yes.
Okay. What's up with the one time? Need a bad world. Wine in the bathtub. You a good girl. Living in the bad world. You got two kids. One from you, one from your sister. That's some good shit. You go to work and do the cooking now, man. I'ma give it to you like you like it. You already know that like a second. I met you on the day that you broke up with your ex-man. I'm a storm in that pussy like an X-Man. Here we go. Remember when I was in, never you rubbers. Oh man, I was tripping like a motherfucker. Went and told your homegirl that I'm grown, girl. End up knocking off your homegirl. Now I'm wrong, girl. No way. Now you know better, man. You know the game. What you consider boring if somebody's changed? I miss our conversations about our future life. I miss our situation, cause that pussy time
through, baby. Alright, Jay, they gotta pay for the rest.
Yeah, y'all gotta pay for the rest.
Yeah, on iTunes too.
That's what I'm talking about. Plug
right,
it.
Right. So Brandon Rossi in the building, man, right
what's
now,
up,
man.
What's up?
I've been low key following you before I knew who you were.
Well, I was gonna say you look familiar. I just
It's like straight up, right? So Rah Rah is probably, I'll say probably how I found, you know, your music. So I was just, you know, Rah Rah was, it was a record that he posted, and I think you were featured on it.
Okay, word.
And I'm like, man, who is this? You know, it's just like, cause I'm new to the name, you know, so I'm like trying to figure out who this is. And then it's just like, I hit Mike up, and Mike's like, nah, man, like little bro, like he producing, singing, rapping. I'm just like, hold up, like everything.
Word,
so, you know what I'm saying? Like, so what's that starting point for you, man? Like, where did all this kind of come from?
Oh, man, well, I'm originally from Decatur, Georgia.
Okay.
So if you're from Decatur, then you know, like, band is like, for real. So yeah. I was in the band in high school.
Hey.
You know what I'm saying?
Same here.
Yeah.
But so. I always wanted to be in the music business. I have a cousin of mine, I call him my uncle, but he was in Frankie Beverly Mays.
Okay.
So I've been wanting to do this, you know
what
I'm saying?
Yeah. Man, that's a good good start right there.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
What instrument in the band? You the drummer?
I play French on trumpet, piano.
Oh yeah,
but so I was a drum major though.
He's
a musician right here for real. Yeah,
for real.
Yeah.
What school?
Southwest DeKalb.
All right,
legit.
I got you.
That's dope.
Yeah, yeah. It's See, man, I grew up in Macon, right? And yeah. Hennessy heard me tell this story before, but like, man, I wanted to be in the band, but our band just went. It wasn't the band to be in. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Oh,
like,
yeah, I understand. Yeah.
We ain't play. Ironically now, like my high school. They play all the stuff I wanted
they
to play.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
It like that in most places that ain't where we from.
Yeah.
The band ain't cool.
Yeah, absolutely, man. So like growing up and being in the band and really having those early influence from your cousin being in Frankie Beverly and Maze, kind of like, you remember like the first time when you felt like, man, I really can, this is not just a hobby for me. Like I can do this.
Yeah. When I was in the 10th grade, I wrote the, We was in the ballad of the band, mm-hmm. And I wrote the intro song, and they let me perform it. So I was like,
this is
what I need to do.
Yeah. Absolutely, man. So which came first, like the musicianship or like singing or rapping?
I would say that actually the musicianship came first.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the first instrument I played was drums. But then I was too young to like stick with the lessons, you know how that
go.
And so I just picked up trumpet because my homeboy, my neighbor, one day I went outside and he was just playing that motherfucker.
Yeah.
Like, who is that? That shit sound fire.
Yeah.
And so ironically, like that same week we had like tryouts at elementary school and I was like, I'm playing the trumpet.
Mm.
And I was just naturally fired at it too.
Mm. Bro, like the part that I love about that story is like, first off, the Atlanta came out of nowhere. He pulled the hood back in Atlanta. But the other thing was, he said like elementary school, it was super young, and like to have people in the neighborhood that was already doing stuff like that.
Yeah,
we don't see that all the time. To have people that's already up on it, and you kind of like, no, like okay, I like what he doing over here.
Right.
Let me go out, you know, like that. That says a lot about your personality. Though, you know what I'm saying? Like definitely.
How did you get to the French horn though?
So what's funny is, I used to go to Chapel Hill Middle School, and we used to go to Southwest after school to practice. And so my eighth grade year in concert band, if y'all don't know, you got marching band and you got concert band. Concert band, my band already says, too many people on trumpet who want to switch.
Right.
So I was like, I switch.
Yeah.
And so I got found there too.
Yeah.
And then that actually became my primary instrument, was the French horn.
Okay, yeah. Okay. That man, he's seeing opportunity, man. Just
yeah.
Like,
oh, yeah,
I'll
do it.
Go ahead and go over
and
here.
And when I got to high school, I did both.
Okay, what, both
trumpet and
French horn. Okay,
yeah, right.
What's your favorite out of both of them?
I want to say the French horn because all my friends they was out playing instruments, and then when I played that, it was just my own shine.
Oh yeah. So do you still like you incorporate those instruments now in your production style?
I really use everything I produce started at the base of the piano.
Okay.
Yeah, even though I may switch the sounds out at some point during the process, but I figured it out on the piano.
Gotcha. Yeah. That's a good starting point. Like,
absolutely.
See, I want to get into production talk, and I know Hennessy might want to get into like some artist talk. I like what's your equipment of choice, man? What you using?
Man, you know I can't tell you. You know what I'm saying? But I'm using some appropriate equipment.
Yeah. I feel you. Using some things.
Yeah, some things.
Hey, you making some quality stuff. I can tell
I
you
appreciate
that. Yeah,
man.
Definitely. I'm a fan of what you got going on, man, and just the whole your whole sound. Like you can tell. It's funny now that I'm having a chance to talk with you, I can tell that you were musically trained.
Yeah,
like just
yeah,
you know, it's just something about listening to the music and like certain notes that people hit it, and some things that are played on keys, it ain't regular. You
that's
know what I'm saying? That's
respect.
Some stuff that you kind of gotta know when to, you know, get you a major chord. We ain't gonna go.
I mean, well, the information is out there. You know, it's just it's up to people to apply.
Mm. Well, you said a mouthful right there.
You know, and that's in all regards of life.
You right though. Like, you know. I saw something, man. I don't know if y'all heard of Gary Vaynerchuk.
Yeah,
nah, I haven't.
So he just looking about when you get a chance. He's a businessman, man. He like probably one of the smartest people that I've seen, well, online talk about business.
Yeah.
But he said something that was so like hit home for me. It was like, man, people talk about, man, why do you give all your information out for free? Why do you give it out for free? He was like, because you ain't gonna use it.
Mm.
So it was like, yeah. I don't mind giving out my stuff for free, because all they do is make me look better, because I'm giving, all you see is like, man, this millionaire, billionaire dude giving me free information. That's all you see.
Right.
But
right.
He know that only a small percentage of people gonna actually apply the stuff that he giving out for free anyway.
Right.
So it works hand in hand for him. It was like, it's cool, I give you all this stuff for free, it don't matter. Like, because when it comes down to it, if you don't know how to apply it, then what you gonna do? You gonna hit him up. And now that's a business opportunity. So I was like, that it blew my mind when he said that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So Hennessy, you got a rapper and a singer next to you. What's that? That million-dollar question.
Wait a minute now. You ain't talking about no goddamn that's a dollar.
See? Yeah, we got a little thing going every time
that's
he gotta put a dollar
in. Well, in his defense,
come on with it, man. Help me out, man. Help me out, man.
You just said you was from Macon, right?
Yeah, I'm from Macon.
Listening to this brother's vernacular, I can tell he from Atlanta as well.
No, he from further south than me.
Oh, yeah.
He from them woods.
I'm from Quitman, right next to Valdosta.
My best friend from Quitman, Georgia.
What?
Hell yeah, swear to God. Grew up with. From Quitman.
Boy, we got to put that. We'll talk about it off camera.
I don't been to Quitman before. You know,
that's crazy.
That's small
and
world.
And I'm a fan of you, so I used to
drop. Oh man.
Oh, you went
to
fam?
You went to school there?
Yeah.
You was in a band?
Nah, I ain't went in the band though.
Yeah. You got to get that straight.
Nah.
I ain't went in the band though.
I went in the band in school and college.
The band crazy though, right?
I mean, on the kind of high school I went to, by the time I got to college, I was over the band. Bro.
Really?
I got you.
I was over marching band. I wanted to be in the orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
That's another story.
Man.
That's it's a small world though. I never would have thought you were like Quitman. Like, bro, if I ever asked anybody something about Quitman, you really gotta be from Quitman to know about Quitman.
I done been to Quitman, Georgia so many times.
That's crazy. That's crazy.
Yeah.
That's wild.
That's wild. That's wild.
Absolutely.
Hennessy, there you go.
It ain't that quiet down here in Quitman. I know a lot of people in Quitman. I just know his whole family, so you know.
Boy, we gotta have a conversation, boy.
Yeah, I gotta have a real
conversation.
Mama and daddy,
so
I know everything.
Yeah, I gotta figure out who this is.
Yeah. Real talk, man.
You probably know him, you know.
I'm sure y'all know each other. Like, not trying to be funny, but like, Quitman ain't.
I'm just saying, you ain't just really gotta say that. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, we good. We cool with them two traffic lights.
Hey, but I'm just saying, bro, like, it's small. So, you know, like, you probably don't ran into them more than likely.
Hey, man. So, homeboat, man, what you working on, man? What's new? Cause I hear this five stuff in my headphone right now. Yeah, I know it's plenty more of that.
Currently, I'm working on my personal project called Private Sanctuary. Okay. Miss Me is a single for that, which you guys are listening to right now. I got Ra-Ra. Me and Ra-Ra work together a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We know as well, we producers and songwriters. You know, we just not... artists. Being a producing songwriter is just as important as being an artist to us too, because we like to make projects and make hit records, you know what I'm saying? So, and then I'm working on Kissy project. I got a few records with Kissy. I'm about to do Jacob Lattimore next project. I got two records on Tip album. I got two records on Jacob album that just came out. I'm just working, bro.
Yeah. I definitely want to ask about the T.I. album, because you own that.
Yeah.
You own the Us or Else.
40 Acres.
Okay.
40
okay.
Acres. That was the record I was trying to think about what it was. That was the one that I saw Ra-Ra put up, the 40 Acres. Tell us, how did that song come about? Like the
man, what's so funny is 40 Acres is like 2 years old. Mm. Whether y'all, you know what I'm saying? Shout out to my boy Pierre Medora. He produced it. Me and P, actually... 40 Acres was written around the time like when Trayvon was going on.
Yeah, right,
so
yeah.
That's when he started. And so we was just at the crib one day, the studio actually just talking. And that's how it kind of came about. And so I'm a fan of, like, I want to release music, but I just don't believe releasing music and then it's just doing nothing. So I held it, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm,
and one day I played in the studio and played for Tip. And Tip, the kind of person that he in the studio, he likes something, he just do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So it was that fast.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
That's dope.
Yeah, no, I've heard those stories about Tip. You know, I had a partner of mine produce Private Show for him. It was very similar situation. Just like, no, we need here. Let's just record.
Yeah, real solid guy.
Yeah, let's do it, you know. And we'll worry about if it's meant to come out, we'll make it come out later on. Like, I like this. Let's record. Right. You know, it's a simple process like that. Definitely simple process.
Yeah, absolutely.
Process. So this record that we're hearing in my head, mm-hmm. headphones right now, is Miss Me record.
Yeah, produced by Supersonics.
Like, for you, we're in a time now where it's not uncommon for people to rap and sing, right?
Absolutely, it's like a new thing. It's cool.
It's a new thing, right? So how do you, with that same thing being said, how do you separate yourself from the rest of the pack that singing and rapping?
I mean, you want to know what, bro? I don't think about separating myself. Mm-hmm. I just be myself. You know what I'm saying? Like, my content is different. My experience is different, and that's where I draw from. You know, it's like if I ask the person what's the difference between John Coltrane and Charlie Parker. Nobody can tell me. If you're not trained and listen to jazz, they both sound the same.
Same,
words.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
they
yeah.
have different moods.
Right. Yeah.
Feel me? It's just like the same thing with music. You know what I mean?
I got you. Man, have you done media training, brother? That's the perfect answer to that. Like, but it's so real at the same time.
I just think nothing is new under the sun. And I'm not saying, like, biting is not cool, because I don't bite. You know what I'm saying? I don't do no biting. I don't do no copying, no swag. But you gonna hear some similarities in artists. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
It's just how it is. You know, when jazz was around, like I said, nobody can tell me the difference between Miles Davis and Dizzy Gillespie.
Yeah.
If you didn't listen to jazz, and jazz was popular music, and the average listener didn't know the difference unless they was announced.
Gotcha.
You know what I'm saying?
So, that made perfect sense, though.
Yeah.
That made perfect sense.
Absolutely.
You about to get me on my jazz tip, man. I got a couple of them records. I don't have a whole lot, but
gotta go, man. Jazz is lit for me, bro. That's what I listen to.
See, that says a lot.
I feel so left out.
Jazz?
I listen to it, but I never know who the artist is.
Exactly, because you don't know what you're listening to.
Right.
Kind of like, you know, jazz generally sounds the same.
It's
right?
like background music.
Yeah, but see, what makes jazz fire is, like, every musician has a technical way of playing.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? That's what make them, that's what separate them.
Right.
Gotcha. That's interesting. Like, I haven't heard it from that perspective before.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, when you put it like that, it makes a lot of sense. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's why they used to be, like, so, like, you know, championing for each other, because they was like, bro, you heard he did?
Because
they musicians. So if you're not a musician, a trumpet sounds like a trumpet, right?
Mm-hmm,
right.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But the mood of Miles Davis versus the mood of Dizzy Gillespie is two different moods.
Mm.
So that's how you can pinpoint him out. You know what I'm saying?
This might be a retarded question.
There's no such thing as a retarded question if you
like
not
you.
Know.
You all right with me?
Absolutely.
Being that you play the trumpet.
Okay.
Do you prefer the sound of just the natural sound of trumpet, or that sound with the muffler?
Muted?
The muted horn. just depends what it calls for. It just depends on the environment. I like both of them equally.
Yeah.
You know, especially if it's Miles. I can take Miles anything.
Right. It's something about, y'all say muted. It's, muted. It's something about that, man. That.
I mean, Miles plays a lot of muted horns. A lot of trumpet players use a lot of muted horns, but it's a mood. It's a mood set. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah, I got you.
What's the vibe? The process like, isn't it, what do they use to mute it? It's like a.
It's like a. It looks like the bottom the backwards plumber.
Plump, yeah, that's it. Okay, you know yeah.
That's actually low key what it is.
Yeah.
Let's
yeah.
just call it that. It's the plumber.
It's the plumber. They just use it to mute that. That's some interesting some conversation here, man. I didn't know we were gonna go here with
band
that.
Talk.
Band talk. Band yeah, talk. Man. It's all good, man. I mean, I know instruments. I went in the band though.
It's all good.
It's all good, man. All right, man.
Low brass class over here. You know, sand, descent.
I dig all brass.
Bro, I played the scenario in elementary school.
Oh, you fine?
That's cool.
Okay, cool. Yeah, man. Cool.
I would say that I feel like at some point everybody should at least try to play an instrument. It's not for everybody. It requires a lot of discipline. I mean, you're not gonna pick it up and just be fine.
Right.
That's with anything that requires.
Yeah, you should try it. I think it teaches discipline, for one.
Oh, absolutely.
Because Lord knows, boy, I ain't like taking that snare drum and them xylophones to school, boy.
Oh, yeah, you had to be responsible for it, take care of everything.
Yeah, absolutely. So I know you said you're working on your music solely right now. I mean, you got other projects in the works, but your music, what kind of time frame are we looking at right now?
Man, actually, I'm in mixing. So, I mean, we're looking from 2-3 weeks to a month.
Okay.
It's like soon, you know what I'm saying?
What is it about it that you can tell us that has you excited about the music, if I can ask that question?
Because I put out projects before, and this one is the first time I felt like I produced 90% of it.
Mm-hmm.
The content is really personal. That's why it's called Private Sanctuary. Because it's just like, has nothing to do with the sanctuary itself. It's just like, that's my personal space of everybody got my sanctuary.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you go in the sanctuary, you treat it as such, you don't just do stuff in the sanctuary. You know
true,
what I'm saying?
True.
So that's my personal place and I'm letting people in.
Mm.
So I'm excited to just share the information on records. Right. And the music is fine.
Yeah.
You talk about how you voted for Trump on there and all this shit?
Absolutely not.
You ain't talk about it.
Man, don't get me started. Actually, let's get me started.
Yeah, go ahead, man.
Okay, so you know how they get all the artists on here and they say, you should vote.
Mm.
I'm an artist who does not vote. Mm. Have I voted before? Yes.
Okay.
Will I be voting ever again? No.
Mm. Mm. You want to go into it?
I mean, if y'all want me to go into it.
Go ahead, man. Hey, explain yourself why.
My friends say I have an extreme way of thinking, but I don't really get caught up in the
politics.
Yeah, the pomp and circumstance of the politics, because it's a part of the game.
Mm-hmm.
I just feel like, I'm going to use this analogy. If you got a $1 trillion company, Hennessy, $1 trillion company, right?
Right.
Would you leave it up to the hands of your employees to decide how y'all going to move?
No.
Exactly. America is $1 trillion company. But in order to avoid chaos among people, we got to give them something. Because if they knew that voting don't work, government have no control.
Mm-hmm.
So we got to let them think they got a part.
Right.
They voted.
Right.
All this hoopla, this protesting. I'm getting it. I'm frustrated too.
Right.
I do recognize the inequalities in society. I'm frustrated about it. But we've been doing the damn same shit for 60 years.
For sure.
Mm-hmm.
For sure.
Protesting and marching is over.
For sure.
It's gone.
It ain't doing nothing but making people mad.
Hey, man.
We trying to approach a government that handles business with moral tactics.
Mm.
Does not work.
The quote, the homie Jay Coop, he got a line that said, it ain't going to be no peace without war. I don't know what you people thinking.
Man, that's the, you know what? I'm pro nonviolent. But
yeah.
That's the only way if they want to change their kind of, there's going to have to be a generation of people that die off.
Mm.
You feel what I'm saying? Because we not fighting a game. They think we fight in particulars. What we are trying to prove with the racism is a fault in mentality. You cannot prove a fault in mentality in court.
Mm.
You feel what I'm saying? We backwards. That's why I'm not out here protesting. I'm not promoting this, the protest, because people don't know what they fighting for.
Right.
We got to get real. We got to organize, bro. Yeah. We got to sit down. We got to think. We got to put our minds together.
Right.
Protesting and all that is cool, but the country is used to civil unrest.
Yeah, and we need civil war.
We just need to regroup.
Right. We need to regroup. Yeah, I mean we have these conversations on this program often though, man. Just talking about how, you know, we as a community we don't want to come together because that coming together means responsibility. And if we don't want to fight, we don't want to have that responsibility to do the things that you're saying we need to do. To you know, you tell somebody not to vote, the first thing they're going to tell you is like, man, my grandfather and grandmother fought for the right.
Well, see, here's the thing. I don't ever want to promote people not to vote.
Okay.
You understand? I'm not here to promote what people believe in. I'm not trying to shadow what they believe. Right. You know what I'm saying? If you vote, that's great. I'm just saying I have gotten to the roots of the issues here. Mm. Okay?
Okay.
I'm not participating. I don't need y'all to try to convince me to do something. By the way, convincing is not true knowledge. If I had to convince you of something is right, then that's just my ideas projected on you. Which has happened to a country of 400 people for years, bro.
Yeah.
This is all I'm saying. We got to be individuals. We got to think as individual people and say, what are we going to do? Not stop living off the ideas of people of a system that was made in the 1800s. We still living off that system. Hmm. It's old.
I like this guy, man.
Dated.
Thanks, Mike. Thanks, Mike.
You know what I'm saying?
Do we need a leader though?
But that's what I'm saying. Like we could have.
See, a part of me believe that, but then the other part of me is like, when we have a leader, now we have somebody to put the responsibility on, and then it take the responsibility off of us.
Bingo! It's like the pastor in the church. Mm. The pastor said, "Bible also say study to show yourself approved." So who are we following here?
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying. A lot of times people don't want to hold themselves accountable. All right. Mm-hmm. I'm going to just come clean and say some hurtful shit right now. All right. The things that black people go through every day, and it's going to sound harsh.
No, you okay? Good. You good with me.
But I'm just coming clean. Good. It's their damn fault.
Mm-hmm. We don't want
to
blame.
We got to look in the mirror. We got to stop trying to beg people. Get up on your own too and make it happen.
Right.
It's opportunities out here. Right. You got all these people who not from America who come and have a better life than black people. Why? Because they not begging for something in the system.
Real.
They working.
For real.
Go do the work.
That's it.
Everything else will fall in place. Go do the work.
Just do the work. Man, that's so real, bro. Like, I've had that conversation with family members.
Like, yeah, I don't even get it to my family no more about none of this.
I had to learn the hard way. Like, we had this conversation. Me and my aunt had this conversation about Trump versus Obama. And I asked her, what has Obama done for you and what has Trump? Like, what if Trump is the in office, what difference is gonna make in your life? Now, she gave me a valid reason for like her job and all that.
Right.
But I was just like, if you lose your job today, what you gonna do tomorrow?
Right.
You're gonna go and get another job, right?
Right.
So it, like, what are we talking about? Right. You know what I mean? And it was the wrong time. It was Thanksgiving. It wasn't the right time to have this conversation, but it just happened. You know, it just kind of came up. Right. But you know, my philosophy is like, bro, like, truth be told, Trump is in office. He the president. I don't care if you want to say he ain't your, he president.
Yeah, and
he
we can't president. And we gotta stop. Like, all right, listen. Now, I didn't vote for Trump, you know, and I really don't care for Trump. But at the same time, we doing the same thing they did to us to him. We slandering the man on the Twitter, on the media. That's not really gonna help the process if we trying to advance as a society. Right. Slandering your president is not gonna work.
Right.
Yeah. Nah, man.
Right.
I'm just saying,
you're right.
We are like champion and fighting for equality, but we not really treating people like
equal.
That. You know what I'm saying?
What are we trying to be equal to?
Oh man, you don't want me to see it.
Well, you said something just
you
did.
Know what I mean? I can't because I don't want to sound like H-Rap Brown, so I'm just gonna be quiet. You know, I know what you're trying to be equal to.
Yeah.
You know what you're trying to be equal to.
Yeah.
I just asked the question and hope
answer. I know exactly.
The thing that you claim to not like, you want to be equal?
The funny thing is, though, that question that you just asked, a lot of us don't realize that that's what we're trying to be. We don't even realize it. You know what I'm saying? We don't see it because it's, like you said, it's a system. It's a system that's just been going on and on and on. Like, your mother lived through it. Your grandmother lived through it. Your great-grandma. Like, everybody don't live through it. And it's like, it's kind of like this, right? My parents love them to death. But ever since I've been a kid, all they've been telling me, go to college. And now, peep this now. I look at my family structure. My dad don't own his own business since 18. Why am I going to college? I'm looking at my dad. Mm. The only reason why I love to do what I do for myself is because I look at him and like, my dad ain't never had a boss since 18. Mm. Why do I want to go to college and get a job so I can have a boss?
Right.
I mean, you know, we... They come from that generation where, first of all, parents couldn't even go to college.
Absolutely. Okay?
So they thought that's the only way to make it in life is to go to college. Like, my mother right now be stressing me, oh, you shouldn't never quit school. But we quit school because we couldn't afford it.
What you mean?
And that's a whole nother issue.
Right. That's what I'm saying. Another like, issue. You kind of got to make it happen for yourself if you want the life. Like, I'm not going to beg nobody for no raise or no job. I'm going to make it happen for myself.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? That's anything. Mm-hmm. If you want your life to be what it is, you got to make it happen for yourself. Mm. And at the end of the day, going to college, your life is still in somebody else's hands. I ain't going for it. Can't nobody tell me I can't do nothing.
Man. I'm sorry, y'all. We went there, but I ain't sorry that we went there like that. You know,
I'm saying, like, I feel like though college is great. I went to college. I learned a lot. I met a lot of people. Actually, if I would have never went to FAMU, I probably would not be sitting right here. Because everybody I met to lead me to the next person in my career started from FAMU.
Mm-hmm.
So college has perks, but I still owe that Sally Mae check for a networking event.
For
sure.
Except for a networking event.
Ah, man, that's another story. That's another conversation. Cause I can go on for hours about the fallacies within inside our government that I feel like we need to go on reform, but I ain't trying to be, you know.
I got you, man. That's something. Matter of fact, some of these conversations, we have the platform, so we got to have them. Right. But some of these conversations need to happen amongst, like, you know, three or four people.
Right.
And then those three or four people go and get three or four people and talk. You know what I'm saying? Because sometimes when we got, like, huge audiences, it's hard to interpret, you know, what's going on. You kind of say like, oh, yeah, he just talking. But if it's like this and we talking now, everything you're saying, I'm feeling it.
Right.
Because it's you know, yeah, we got plenty of people watching, but it's us right here. And that's right. Okay.
And I got to also add, like, I'm not in the right or wrong business. I don't think the way I think is right. It just comes from understanding. Because what we trying to do is fight for equality in life, at the bottom line, right? But our approach is trying to, like, attack systems. Okay, systems aren't set up for morale. They do not care about what's right or wrong. The system is only benefited for the system.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So we have to regroup. I feel like we need to regroup and reorganize, and we need to challenge these systems, and we need to challenge the people who implemented the systems in place. You know what I'm saying? Because that's what we really fighting. We're not really fighting the people. The people who making sure that things go through in the system, that's their job. The judge's job is to send your ass to prison for life.
Sure.
That's his job. You know, there are mandatories for crimes you commit. With people like that, ain't that's wrong. That's the law.
That's the law.
That's the world we live in. Y'all think y'all fighting for the government. The government is not based on, oh man, this is the right thing to do.
Right.
There are rules in place. Learn the rules. Play the game. It's Monopoly.
Hey man,
I ain't worried about you
at all.
You gonna be alright.
At all.
You gonna be alright.
I ain't going for it. Yeah. Hey, hey, like how you just sum that up, was that was it.
Yeah.
That was it. Know the rules.
It's hard to convey that though to people who are out here fighting for rights. If you live in the United States, I don't care how much money you got or who you know, you don't have no rights.
Break that down. Break that down.
At any given time, the government can switch this whole joint up because it's built off laws that we don't control. In order for us to change the law, we gotta go through a step. What you gotta do? Who your local leader? Then he got to go to somebody else. Then he got to go to somebody else. It take years to get laws changed, bro. Right. We need effective laws now, like right now. There's a lot of tons of innocent people in jail, which pisses me off. You know what I'm saying? It's a lot of, why can't we get sex trafficking under control? Atlanta's the hub for it.
You know why?
Exactly.
Somebody else getting cut a check.
Absolutely. That's what I'm saying. A lot of these things they promote that we need to fix, they not fixing it. It's just like the old ball and chains, drag them along. Come on. We just need y'all money. Pay our tax. Yeah, okay, yeah, we gonna fix this. We don't never fix it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Man, something very small, right? And my wife is great on doing this. So in my neighborhood, the intersection, the light went out. Traffic light. Blinking, you know. And most people in the neighborhood don't know that. All you gotta do is call 311 or 511. They'll get somebody out to fix it right then and there. The light went for 2 days like that. And my wife was like, did you call? I was like, no, I ain't called. She was like, if you know what to do, why do what you need to do? Like, you know what to do. You know if you call 311, 511, they'll get somebody out here.
Right.
And it didn't cross my mind. It's just like, I'm waiting for somebody else to do something. It's the same thing. And that's just a small example. Like, we keep waiting for everybody else to, we waited for Obama to get in office and to make change.
Right.
Now we waiting on whoever coming after Trump to get in office and make change. Like, bro, like, just do what you can do on your level right now.
I'm gonna give you a quick thing, and then I know y'all gotta go. I'm gonna tell y'all something I learned from Rob this year about my personal music career, right? So me and Rob been coming up since we were 17. He used to be signed to JD. We both done had our little in and outs with record labels and all of that, right? So when I saw Rob start handling his career like a businessman, shit started happening. So when I start handling my career like a businessman, shit started happening. If y'all want change in y'all communities, stop begging. Stop marching for rights. Get on your business. These people that's affecting you, stop going to Walmart. Y'all ain't gotta go to Walmart.
You don't.
Stop going to Walmart. Trader Joe's is just as cheap as Walmart, guys. And it's healthy.
Yeah.
Just figured I'd tell y'all that.
And it's just a little plug. Yeah.
Straight up. And by the way, when black people pissed me off because when Obama got in the office, they just felt like life was gonna be better because he was black.
Oh yeah, 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 yeah.
It's that kind of thinking that's fucking us up. Right. It ain't the system. It's y'all thinking. Stop blaming people. Look in the mirror, switch it, and let's go. Let's do it. That's all I'm saying.
Don't kill me. But maybe that's why I think that Trump might be a gift.
Cause it's gonna force people in.
You feel me? Yeah. Now, absolutely. If Hillary would have got in there, niggas probably would have went right back to sleep.
We would have relaxed. We would have been relaxed.
Cause that's what we did for 8 years. We went to sleep.
We went to sleep. We good. Obama in.
You said 8 years?
Yeah.
We've been asleep about 600.
I feel you. We went into deeper sleep then.
Went deeper sleep.
The first 100 years we've been asleep, that wasn't our fault.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
We was in hibernation mode for them
yeah,
8 years.
Yeah.
We was in hibernation mode. Yeah, you absolutely right though.
Yeah.
It's like, and we saw it the first day too. Like when all the women across the world marched.
By the way, that was five love women. Y'all so fighting me. Y'all
like,
y'all be doing it.
Just to do, and I know we said like, you know, stop marching, but what that showed to me was like, we can come together and make something happen. Like, yeah. All I'm talking about, dude, I didn't even know what was going on. Like, real talk, I thought the march was just something that was happening here. I didn't realize it was going on like all over the world. People was marching, basically marching against Trump. So I'm like, if we can move like that in one day.
Yeah.
Come
man,
on.
Man, I really dig the urgency of women. They just like, look, this ain't right. But, you know, hate to be the Debbie Downer on the protest.
No, please do.
What are we going to do, guys?
Yeah, right. Yeah.
What are we going to do? All this protest and all these conspiracy theories, we know all the information. What are we going to do? That's what I'm saying. I'm in the business of solutions. I haven't really figured out a solution. But when I do, y'all will know.
There we go. And on that note, man, tell the people, how can they connect with you on social media?
Man, y'all need to go follow me on Instagram at Lord Rossi, LXRD Rossi. Same thing with Twitter. I be tweeting a lot. This same kind of rhetoric. I tweet this all the time. You know, you can talk to me. I ain't bougie. I ain't one of them artists. I ain't that popping yet.
Say, put that yet on there. Put that yet on.
Absolutely. And go get my single, Miss Me, on iTunes. It's everywhere title. You know, just go listen to it.
Hey, man, y'all go ahead and get that. Matter of fact, I already got it, but I'm gonna buy it right here.
Private Sanctuary, somewhere around the corner.
Yeah, man. They just see, here's the thing, man. What artists I really try to stress to the artists that I talk to. You get on here selling your music, ain't gonna sell your music. We just had a 40-minute conversation with bro.
That's 40 minutes?
It might be.
Oh man, that's crazy.
I'll put it like this. Anything you drop, I'm going to support. Just off of the conversation that we just had. Because now I know, like, you know what? Not only is he dope on the music side, but he a dope individual.
For sure.
I appreciate that. Dope individual. Much love and respect. Thank you.
Definitely. For sure, man. Oh, Miss Me. Boom.
Oh, yeah, there it go.
I don't mean to play it. I mean, I can play it, but I want to buy it.
Dang hard, too.
Oh, I'm playing it. Hold on. I'm tripping, bro. I'm in Apple Music trying to buy the song. I feel like an old person. I'm an old person on this thing. I got to go to the iTunes.
You look at your iPhone like this.
Hey, you got like this. Yeah, how you doing, bro? Yeah. Hey, man, but look, bro, we appreciate you coming through,
sure,
man.
I appreciate y'all, man. Definitely. Thank you.
Yes, sir, man. And you welcome back anytime.
Anytime,
bro.
I appreciate that.
Love
you.
Anytime, man. Well, look, we'll be right back.
For sure.
Good Hennessy Show.